Back at the dissection, we want to investigate further how the thoroughbred's remarkably thin yet powerful limbs work. It's incredible that such matchstick legs survive the crushing impact each time they hit the ground. By placing a forelimb in a press, we'll see the stresses it undergoes as the horse accelerates to a gallop.
OK, we're in the jig now. Joy, do you want to start pumping?
So now this would be starting to take some load when it's walking and carrying the weight on there.
Yes, if you feel the tendons, you can feel that they're under load. They're getting like a piece of taut wire.
Very taut. You've got one there, the second one there, the deeper one.
Yep.
So you've got big, solid bands.
And they're coming all the way down from up here on the elbow and all the way down to the foot. We're probably looking like trotting at the moment. So the cannon bone is actually getting the load of these tendons and the weight, compressing it and bending it, because the tendons are trying to bend it like a bow backwards.
So this is like the bow and that's the string?
Yes.
Can we load this a bit more to see what happens when it would be at full gallop?
Yep.
How low would that fetlock get?
It will come down to about here.
Wow.
Just listen for cracking.
Keep going.
Keep going.
Okay.
And, well,
stop in there.
No, keep going.
Keep going? Further than that?
Yep.
I can't believe how much that's spent.
That is extraordinary.
The tendon is 20 or 30 times better than a steel spring in storing energy.
A horse's leg works like a pogo stick, compressing and recoiling. When a leg hits the ground, the downward forces cause the fetlock joint to drop to an almost horizontal position, absorbing some of the shock. Tendons running down the back of the leg act like springs, stretching to allow the joint to drop, but preventing it from collapsing. The stretched tendons store elastic energy, which propels the leg into the next stride. This allows the horse to move as fast as possible, expending the least amount of energy, while cushioning the leg from impact.
So, Alan, we've now got a leg at gallop, fully loaded. What if another leg hits the back of the tendon through the very thin skin?
Oh, that tendon's under load and it will really break quite easily. I'll just, with a scalpel, come round the back here.
Wow.
And that's what would happen in your overbeat.
Wow.
End of racing career.
But when this is working as it's supposed to, this is a beautiful piece of engineering.
Absolutely superb. We don't have the sort of materials in engineering that we do in biology.
The thoroughbred's limb is the secret to its success, but is also its Achilles heel.
In nature, when natural selection favours some particular characteristic, it's got to keep being viable, got to keep surviving in all other respects as well. So it can't just go relentlessly favouring running speed. But with racehorses bred by humans, where it's actually humans who do the selecting rather than nature, because humans can feather bed domestic animals and keep them alive, it's possible for us to breed single-mindedly and relentlessly for one characteristic, in this case, just plain running speed, and never mind if the animal ends up less viable, less able to survive in other ways. And I'm afraid that is the case with racehorses.
Racing is a high-risk sport for both the horses and the jockeys. The Grand National is as famous for its casualties as its champions. Out of every 1,000 horses that run a race, 2 will die, and a third of those deaths are due to fractures. But are some racehorses more prone to injury than others? The measurements taken on Eclipse 200 years ago are helping to solve this mystery.
What have you discovered then, having had this incredible archive of information from this superstar horse?
Well, we got very similar measurements from contemporary racehorses, and we looked at how did Eclipse compare to this. And I have to say, and it astonished me a bit, he was actually average.
That's the surprise, isn't it?
Yeah.
That actually that has to confer some kind of advantage.
Yes. The thing is, it does make sense in a way, because This is a racing machine at the very limit of the speed it can do without breaking down. But there has to be a trade-off, because obviously if you're injured, you don't run fast. But also if you run fast, you're more likely to get injured. So only the horses that strike the middle of this will be successful.
So actually being average is an advantage.
I think so. You know, I love going to the races. I enjoy racehorses. I know so do you and so do many people. But I think we have the responsibility, especially as vets, to make sure these horses remain healthy.
To reveal the horse's final line of defence against the pounding its limbs receive, we need to look at a cross-section through the lower leg. We'll see how it survives the shock of transferring a ton of weight each time the foot strikes the ground.
Ah, good bandsawing, sir. That is a beautiful thing, isn't it, when you cut through it in section like that. So just take us through.
Yep. Long pastern, short pastern, coffin bone, then the hoof wall.
So that's the nail on the outside.
So that's the nail. All this load is transferred to this coffin bone, and it then hangs off the hoof wall, these laminae, which are like sheets of tissue connecting that to the bone. So if we turn the foot over, these are in this region here. So when the foot's on the ground, the coffin bone is hanging off these, pulling this hoof wall down, spreading the tops of the heels outwards, and then the whole hoof is kind of hinging backwards and outwards.
So all of the forces distributed to the outside, almost like a bell shape.
Yes.
The coffin bone is not attached directly to the sole of the foot. It hangs from the hoof wall, suspended by several layers of tough tissue called laminae. This means that each time the horse lands on one foot, the entire body weight transfers to the hoof wall, dampening the force. The hoof wall is made of horn, which flexes and spreads the load further. This shock absorbing is most dramatic at the heels, where the horn is younger and softer. It's a brilliant mechanical solution, a living, growing structure that can withstand immense forces. But the horse's feet did not evolve for the pressures of roads and racing, so they need additional protection.
Ideally, we're looking for the most symmetrical foot we can make it without distorting the hoof wall too much. Basically, this is the hoof wall all the way around here, and we're working within the perimeters of the white line that runs just inside it. So basically, anything outside of that is what I can work with. Anything inside of that is the horse's, you know. We're trying to protect what's inside.
We have been nailing metal shoes to horses' feet for more than 1,500 years.
Across the horse world, that expression, no foot, no horse, everybody knows it. You work with their feet the whole time. Do you think it's valid?
Without a doubt, that's the only thing in contact with the ground. And, you know, they soon let you know if there's something wrong with their feet.
We're beginning to put together the puzzle of how something the size of a horse can move at such speeds. But to really understand how it achieves this, you have to go deep inside.